Well, we're going to speak about developmental macroeconomics. Or new developmental macroeconomics. Depends. It's the same thing. Well, it's not a paper. It's a class. It's a summary of three books that I have been publishing. I published in the last years. The first book was called, in English, Developing Brazil, and was published by, it was about Brazil. But I was trying to make developing a macroeconomics for Brazil. But I believe that macroeconomics is a very historical kind of theory. So you should have a macroeconomics for Brazil. And I was developing a new models, and so I used this in this. This was publishing, I think, in the US in 2009 or 2008. And in Portuguese, it was called Macroeconomics of Stagnation. The name in English is not good, but anyway, it's what developed in Brazil. Then I published here in France a book called Mondialisation et Compétition, que a été après, after published in Portuguese, in English, Spanish, Globalization and Competition. Well, I have the basic, at that moment, the basic papers on this developmental macroeconomics. The title is no good because the title gives idea of a book, a different kind of book. And recently, last year, Routledge published a book, now is by myself plus Oreiro and Marconi, two very good young for me. They are 50 years old. One 40, other the older. For me, they are very young. And the book calls Developmental Macroeconomics. This book is supposed to be published in Brazil in the end of the or in the beginning of next year, with some revisions. Well, so, and this is a process, these are a system of ideas that I have been developing since 2001. I could say also through my whole life, but this is not true. When I focus on this kind of a thing, and I began to develop a theory, because what I'm going to present to you is theory. I'm not going to present you any data, demonstrations, econometric studies, all the things that you have to learn to do and you have to do. And I hope that if these models that I, or these ideas and models that I'm going to present to you very simply, that you can make them more formal and can check this. There are several papers already doing that in Brazil and other places, but I hope that you do too. So have to be here. Well, new developmentalism. Developmental macroeconomics is part of new developmentalism. This is the name that came to be. It originates, this new developmentalism, from development economics that I also prefer to call, instead of development economics, classical developmentalism. Because development economics is a very general expression. That when development economics was very important between the 40s and the 60s, and the World Bank assumed this theory, this makes. But after that, development economics lost importance. Anyway, I prefer to call this classical developmentalism. These are associated with Rosenstein, Rodin, Nerx, Lewis, Prebisch, Furtado. This kind of people, I know. I hope that you know are. You know them. Well, and this originates also from post-Keynes and macroeconomics. I personally, I was formed learning these two kind of things. Keynesian first, then post-Keynes and economics, and learning classical developmentalism. But it is supposed to be a new thing, called the new developmentalism. And this new developmentalism is divided. You can see in this new developmentalism theory a new developmental macroeconomics, or developmental macroeconomics. The perfect name would be new developmental, but too much new. A new developmental political economy. In the political economy, you discuss the developmental state, the developmental class coalitions, and things like that. There are several things already written about this, others in process of being written. And a new developmental macroeconomics, from which there is just a draft. But it's important to also, especially it's important to have in mind that capitalist economies are divided in two sectors, one competitive and the other non-competitive, and especially the infrastructure, but not only, and the competitive sector, the market is supposed to make the coordination, period. While in the non-competitive, the state is supposed to make the coordination, period. Now, there's some gray areas between, but this is very important to have this. And another thing is that industrial policy, that's a part of the microeconomics, is not a substitute for good macroeconomics and for macroeconomics equilibrium. And this theory is focused in middle-income countries. So I'm not speaking about all countries. I'm speaking about developing countries, and especially among developing countries, the middle-income countries, less on the poor countries, and less also to developed countries. But several of these things can be used for also for rich countries. I have a paper that's in my site. I have a big site with almost everything that I wrote. And there's a paper there about applying these theories to the euro crisis today here. Now, it's for the middle-income countries. And an important thing, the key difference in this macroeconomics from of the macroeconomics, developmental macroeconomics for normal macroeconomics, is that the key difference in relation to rich countries, I'm sorry, in relation to the macroeconomics to rich countries, is that developing countries get indebted in foreign money. You never should forget this, because this makes a huge difference. It's what people call also, there is a name for this, the original thing. Well, this theory adopts the historical deductive method. This is very important. I don't know if you learned about this here in this class or in the other courses that you made in your life. I hope you did. And so I'm going to just repeat. But I think that you can divide sciences in two types of sciences, the substantive sciences and the methodological sciences. And the substantive science, then you divide, as you know, between the social science and the natural science. Okay? Given this, this classification, now, what is the method appropriated for the sciences? For the substantive sciences is the empirical method. And the empirical method, when you speak about social sciences, is the historical method. While, when you speak, the method that is appropriated for the methodological sciences, this is the hypothetical deductive method. Mathematics. This is a methodological science. Econometrics. This is a methodological science. Decision-making theory. This is a methodological science. These sciences use a hypothetical deductive method. But when you have a substantive sciences, that you have to discuss something existing, The methodological science has no object, has objective to help reasoning, no object. Then you should use the empirical, in our case, historical method. You can observe, I am not going to discuss this here, but this means that I have no sympathy whatsoever for neoclassical economics. Because neoclassical economics is essentially wrong, essentially fraudulent, wrong, because it adopts the hypothetical deductive method to a social science, to a substantive science, substantive social science. This makes no sense, absolutely. What you have to do is to generalize behaviors of economic agents. See how you do, how the in natural science you do, you should do also here. You should see what repeatedly happens, which are the tendencies and the repetitions. And from this you develop your models. And you can find after this rational reasons for that. But neoclassical economics does this different. It transforms men in robots. These robots have always the same response to one input, same thing, because they always maximize and optimize. And this makes models that are big castles in the air. Essentially, a big ideology. Neoclassical economics, to my view, is the scientific scientific demonstration of it intends to be the scientific demonstration of neoliberalism. Well, but look, you use the historical data. So what I'm supposed to do is to, we economists are supposed to do is to use the historical deductive method. This was done by Adam Smith. This was done by Marx. This was done by Keynes. Well, the three more important economists in the history. But this was done also by Marshall. That's a big economist. This was not done by Marshall. Marshall also used the historical deductive method to study industrialization and other things. But the real contribution that he has to economic theory is his microeconomics. That's undoubtedly a genial, a very thing. And this is hypothetical deductive. So I got in trouble when I was writing this paper. It took me about 20 years to write this paper. It's called The Two Methods and the Hard Core of Economics. I'm summarizing here in two words. But after some time, I found a solution for this. Actually, Marshall was beginning the development of a new methodological science. In this science is economic decision making, which has two branches. One is his microeconomics, and the other is game theory. But this is a discussion. Yet, this theory accepts theorems. There are some theorems that are very interesting and that we should take in consideration. For instance, theorems are logical constructs like the law of comparative advantage, or the Balassa-Samuelson effect, or the Marx theory of plus value, or if you want, the general equilibrium. These are theorems. What's a theorem? So a theorem is a logical reasoning that starts from a premise and concludes with the end of the, and has a logical reasoning inside it. Some of these reasonings are good, some are very dangerous, but can be good anyway, although dangerous. Look, for instance, the general equilibrium. It's a very dangerous. Vargas was entirely misrepresented in his thinking because everybody used his general theory to say things that he would shiver. He was very much involved in understanding the reality of the economies. But I'm saying this. But when you accept, but there is a big difference here, is that you don't derive policy from hypothetical deductive or theorems, models or theorems. You only can deduct policies from historical models. Yes. And this was, it's funny, this was discovered by Schumpeter. Schumpeter is the fifth, for me, of the five more economists, the fifth is Schumpeter. Doesn't matter, the order is not very important. And he spoke about the Ricardian vice. And then when I read this for the first time, it was very strange for me. Ricardian vice. What's Ricardian vice? For Schumpeter, is to deduce from the models, from the theory, policy. But look, I don't do policy for any other reason than to, I don't do theory and don't study theory only for being able to intervene and to have policies and to improve my, the sort of my society. Makes no sense for me to develop theories that have no utility. But Schumpeter was right, because he observed clearly. He also thought historically, not historical deductively. Sometimes he made some for the Harvard people where he was teaching, but he was not a neoclassical economist by no means. No? So the Ricardian vice is very important. And one important thing then is that when you accept the historical deductive method, you have to be modest. When you adopt the hypothetical deductive method, as neoclassical does do, you can mathematize everything, because the hypothetical deductive method is the method of mathematics. If it's also the method of economics, it's not. But the neoclass do as if they were, it was. Then you can also construct a whole system only with mathematical equations, one after the other. You fill one blackboard, another blackboard, and this goes in, finished. You know everything about economics after this wonderful exercise. What means nothing. Look, new developmentalism should not be mixed with vulgar developmentalism or vulgar Keynesianism. What's vulgar Keynesianism or vulgar? In other words, it would be populist Keynesianism or populist. Developmentalism. Okay, I manage. Look, this word populism is a very broad word, but there are two senses for the word. One is the classical sense, is the political sense. And populism is this, there's many definitions, but anyway, to simplify, populism is the practice of some political leaders of having a direct relation with the people without the intermediation of the political parties and of ideologies. And why they do that? And this populism is a thing normal when you begin to develop a country and you began to have to develop politics in this country. The political parts don't exist, or don't exist, or exist in very feeble ways. They don't represent really ideologies. The people don't understand about ideologies. So you don't have alternative but to be a populist originally. You have the great leaders that have very important for their countries, like Andrew Jackson, for instance, United States. This is 1824, more or less. Getulio Vargas in Brazil, that was the more important statesman of Brazil in the 20th century, that were populists in the political sense. You can have bad things also. But what interests us here is economic populism. And the economic populism is an expression that was developed in the 80s, late 80s, more or less associated with the Washington Consensus, but it's not Washington Consensus. It's a good thing to express simply the economic populism is to spend irresponsibly more than it gets. But whom? But when this definition was presented, what was assumed was just one type of populism. And this populism is fiscal populism. So economic populism is the state to spend responsibly more than it gets, involving large budget deficits or fiscal deficits. I say, okay, I fully agree with this concept, but I propose a second one. And the second one is exchange rate populism. Populismo cambial, exchange rate populism. And what's exchange rate populism? Is the nation state, is the country to expend more than it gets and they get involved in large current account deficits. This you never heard about, I'm sure. Almost sure. So these are two things. They are too bad. When you say irresponsibly, you are already saying that's bad. No? The current account deficits, pardon, budget deficits, they are the great proposition, policy proposition of Keynes, when there is when it is a countercyclical, but only in this condition. And you are not always in this condition, as a lot of vulgar Keynesians think. They are populists. As to exchange rate populism, especially neoclassical economists, but also orthodox economists, they like them because it's foreign savings, and foreign savings should be good or is good. No? I say no, it's not good, but this is will be a main problem here in this class. The current account debts are bad. I would say probably worse than budget deficits. For some time, there are good reasons for have budget deficits when you have a recession. I don't found any reason to find to a country to involve, or almost any reason to a country to get involved in current account deficits. But look, this is very heterodox, because look what happened here in his country. Well, what happened in the euro area? In this crisis, Spain and not all the countries in the south, but especially Spain and Ireland, they were very severe, very orthodox, if you want, in terms of budget deficits. No budget deficits, almost. In the case of Spain, zero the budget deficit. In the case of Ireland, even some surplus. They're reducing the public debt ratio to GDP in these two countries. The deficits were much smaller than Germany's. Biden then went in a big crisis because they had huge current account deficits. Current account deficits that the economists didn't bother because current account deficit is normal. No. Oh, there is another way of explaining this. Because there is what is called the Lawson Doctrine. This Lawson was the finance minister of Madam Thatcher. And he said, he used to say that the private sector is always in equilibrium. The public sector is that can be out of equilibrium. So, the problems that in the current account that derive from the private sector, these are short-term problems that will be solved fast. These are ridiculous things that you hear about this. But you'll be back. Well, this developmental macroeconomics, this is just a trailer. It is based on the five macroeconomic prices. This is very important. When you study macroeconomics, you study macroeconomics and you study aggregates. Okay, but you study also prices. But some are, Keynes, for instance, made the general theory without the exchange rate because he made a closed model. Only after, he wasn't wise. He was the more important economist of the 20th century and he was wise doing that because it became too complicated to include the exchange rate in the process. But anyway, normally the profit rate is forgotten when you study. Oh, there is the marginal efficiency of capital, but this is just a line. The shifts of this line are forgotten normally, and so on. Here, no, the five macroeconomic prices are fundamental. Second, it's focused on the current account and the exchange rate instead of being focused in the interest rate and the budget deficit. This doesn't mean that the budget deficit and the interest are not important at all. They are very important. But it's focused in this other thing that is not so discussed. It views the profit rate, that's more important, that is wrong. It views that the profit rate is the more important macroeconomic price, and the exchange rate the more strategic price. Why the profit rate is the more important price? Because capitalism only exists with profits. In Brazil, we had 12 years of PT government that had my support in most of the time, but it failed finally. In economic terms, not in distribution. Distribution he did a good job, but he failed in economic terms in causing development and creating a developmental class coalition because it finally wanted to have a capitalism without profits. And this makes no sense. Profits are very important in economic theory. It views the exchange rate policy. Policies, it is fundamental. All that I'm going to do, you'll be interested, persuaded or not, if you were persuaded that exchange rate policy is a very important thing. You look at your books of macroeconomics, there is no title about macroeconomic exchange rate policy, because the exchange rate is endogenous and things like that. Rejects the growth with foreign indebtedness or foreign savings. These are very strange things I should discuss. It shows middle-income countries don't need foreign capital. These two things that are just are together, rejecting growth with foreign savings and showing that developing countries don't need foreign capital. You don't need the capital of the French, of the American, of the Chinese, whatsoever. Don't. It does not offer relevant contributions to fiscal and monetary policy, except in the 80s theory of national inflation. So I'm not going, this theory focuses where in a sector that economic theory was very, easy in my view, very poorly developed. in terms of monetary policy, in terms of fiscal policy, is very well developed. Lots of major economists have written and discussed in the exchange rate, not. It's a niche. Okay. The five macroeconomic prices. Look at the five, the profit rate, the exchange rate, the interest rate, the wage rate, the inflation rate. These are the five macroeconomic prices. And they must be right. But right, not in the neoclassical sense. Right for them, right is when is the price that the market freely develops, establishes. So ridiculous. No, the profit rate must be satisfying or satisfactory. Satisfying is the expression I forgot the name of the great economist. Satisfying or satisfactory to businessmen, to business enterprise, to invest. This, how much this is changes a little, depends on situations. But there is, after some level, the businessmen are satisfied and they begin to invest. If the profit is very small or zero or negative, for sure they don't invest. So you have to have a satisfactory rate of profit. Second, this is one of the more interesting things of this theory. The exchange rate, but for the beginning, should be a set for a profit rate to competent firms, or to firms that utilize technology in the old state of the art. It's obvious, no? But it's not so obvious. We're going to be back to this. The interest rate should be low, should have a low level. This is important in the case of Brazil. I'm not saying that the interest rate should be low, because it depends on the monetary policy. But I say that it should be low, the level around which you make the monetary policy. In Brazil, in some other countries, Turkey, it's very high. And wages should be consistent with a satisfying rate of profit, should be growing with productivity, and inflation should be below two digits. No, below one digit is impossible. Two digits, that's wrong. We'll be back to this, especially the exchange rate. How to make the macroeconomic price right? Very simply, a responsible counter-cyclical fiscal policy, a monetary policy based on level of the interest rate, a wage policy making wages to increase with productivity, and mainly an exchange rate policy that makes the exchange rate competitive through a once and for all depreciation. This, I put the here because I didn't say yet, so it makes confusing. That's the basic tendency of this theory. This theory has I explain in a minute. Second, it must neutralize the tendency to the overvaluation of the exchange rate, thus assuring that it will remain floating around this competitive level. These are not going to understand for a moment, in a minute. So I have to explain these things of the exchange rate. Well, this is beginning ainda. Just to remember, the economic development or productivity involves a productive sophistication. Productive sophistication is a good word to substitute for industrialization, because today you have services that are very sophisticated, so productive sophistication helps. And what's important to remember is that productive sophistication, you can have the increasing productivity in the same service and or good, and transferring labor from low productivity for low value added per capita, low wages to high. What I suggest to you, you can increase the productivity of this glass, increase, no? Or you can increase the productivity of this glass, the productivity of this country, changing from the production of this glass to this microphone. That's more sophisticated. And this second one is the more important of the two ways of the supply factors, as education, technical progress, and the good institutions are essential, but are embedded into capital accumulation and have long effect only. This is a long discussion. What's essential here is the last line. Economic development depends essentially on the investment rate. This was demonstrated many times, infinitely, although the Solow model tells us that the investment rate is not important, but this was proved all the time that this is what makes. Then there is a residuum, and then technology is important, but technology that's important is embedded in capital. Oh. Well, so this theory has an investment function. And this investment function begins to be different. Look, what depends on the investment? For the classical school, not the neoclassical, I put classical here. I am very fond of Marx, especially. The classical school, it depends on the expected profit rate and the interest rate. If there is a difference in between both, we're going. This is simple. Everybody knows, everybody agrees. You have to agree. This is logical. And you can verify it happens. Well, but Keynes came and said, well, yes, but the profit rate, the expected profit rate, depends on demand, which is not assured by the market. And this is general theory. Okay, and this made him the more important economist of the 20th century. Well, what we say in new development is, okay with the classical, okay with Keynes, but firms must have access to demand. Access to demand, which is not assured by the market, because, okay, but by a competitive exchange rate, which is not assured by the market because this exchange rate tends to be overvalued in the long term. I didn't put this phrase here because I'm going to say put in the other slide. This is fundamental here. This is true, or what I'm saying here makes very little sense. Here, the core of this theory is a tendency. I told you that this theory is a historical theory, so it has tendencies. Like the classical school, it had a tendency. The tendency to the falling rate of profit. Smith had one, Ricardo had another, and Marx had another. This is very important. I wrote a full book many years ago about this. Keynes has a tendency. He does not use this expression, but it's the tendency to the insufficiency of demand. The classical developmentalism. I have to manage here this. Classical developmentalism has famous prebish tendency to the deterioration of the terms of trade, the terms of exchange of trade, is a better word. And new developmentalism, what I'm trying to discuss with you, it has a tendency to the cyclical and the chronic, means in the long term, overvaluation of the exchange rate. This means that the exchange rate goes, that the country goes from crisis to crisis, from sudden stop to sudden stop. When there is a crisis, the exchange rate depreciates strongly, then it appreciates, appreciates. Some years later, it again, you discuss this more. So this is fundamental. Exchange rate volatility. Well, for the neoclassical school, there is volatility, but very small. The misalignments, small misalignments. For the Keynesians, they are big misalignments, but still misalignments. For this theory, you don't have really misalignments. You have the tendency to the cyclical and the chronic overvaluation. What's the difference? You see in the graphic. But before, well, maybe the graphic comes immediately after. It's easier to, voila. In this graphic, the red line is the equilibrium, the current equilibrium I'm going to discuss. And the blue line is the neoclassical and Keynes. I prefer when they have two lines, one for the neoclassical, more sweet, and the other for the Keynesians plus more. But these two lines, or this one that makes the synthesis of both, they are misalignments because they are always floating around the equilibrium, more or less, but around with no direction. When you have the tendency to the cyclical and the chronic revaluation of the exchange rate, things are different. Because now the equilibrium is the same. But look, you have a crisis and a big depreciation. Then you have appreciation, several years of an appreciated currency, big current account deficits. And finally, creditors lose confidence, another crisis, balance of payment crisis or currency crisis. This is very important. The rich countries, the financial crisis are essentially banking crisis. They can have in certain cases balance of payment crisis, but not normal because they get indebted in their own money. While us, developing countries, we get indebted in the other's money, and so we have currency crisis or balance of payment crisis. So this is here are two balance of payment crises and a long-term appreciation in between. And this changes everything. This is not a misalignment in the sense that it's a direction, in the sense that you can understand some logic in this process. That the exchange rate is not just volatile and wild, so with no explanation. No, there is explanation. It's not perfect. Remember that in the beginning when I was speaking about the method. I said that this theories that utilize the historical deductive method, as the one that I'm presenting to you, these theories are modest, I said. How they disappears? With expression, with adverbs like generally this happens, usually this happens, probably this happens. You don't, when you speak about theorems, this finished, it's logical. The problem is logical, it's not economical. No, this happens generally, approximately. Causes of this tendency. This is essential. There is a structural cause. And the structural cause is the Dutch disease. And forget that, but it's just polls because I cannot explain this now, a little later. And three, habitual policies. This is interesting. We are going back to this again. But look, when you make models, historical models, you have to make them considering the behavior of economic agents. And which are the economic agents? Are the consumers, are the producers, are the investors, are the exporters, are the importers, etc. Well, I offered to you a different kind of, in this case, I offered you in this case of the three arbitral policies, the agent are the policymakers. The policy in general, except, I could put the thing, the policymakers, except in East Asia. But, and the Dutch disease, no? This is a structural cause. Well, to understand the Dutch disease, no? Then I'm going to discuss the other cause. We have, we'll see that in this class, or in this macroeconomics, in this developmental macroeconomics, that we have three equilibriums for the exchange rate. The current equilibrium, the industrial equilibrium, and the foreign debt equilibrium, or fundamental. The current equilibrium, we are going to be back to this strongly, the first and second, is the value that balances intertemporally the current account of the country. That line, that red line that I had presented for you, it expresses the value of the foreign exchange. A moment for the value. The industrial equilibrium is the value that makes competitive the firms that utilize technology in the old state of the art. These two equilibriums should be equal. But when you have the Dutch disease, this is a disease, or this is a curse, the natural resource curse, is synonym for me. Ish, todo meu dinheiro foi embora. Eu tô com a... Pronto, eu não sei porque eu abri aqui a minha... Hã? Ah, olha aí, olha só, eu realmente estava... Tem outro, depois pega. Tirar, o que eu faço com essa carteirinha de moeda no, na minha mão é que eu não sei. Pronto, olha aí, tinha aqui outro. Pronto. Ai, ai. No bolso. Então, quando você... when you have... Normally, you don't have this tweak. What economic theory tells you is that the firms that use technology in the old state of the art, they are competitive. And what I'm saying, no, that is different. The exchange rate will be determined by the current equilibrium, will be the current equilibrium, and the exchange and this industrial will be different, more appreciated, more depreciated. And the foreign equilibrium is the exchange rate that corresponds to current account deficit that stabilizes the foreign debt. I will be back to this in the moment later. Dutch disease. This is a very interesting part of this model. Or synonym, natural resource curse. It is a long-term overvaluation of the exchange rate, or it is a competitive disadvantage that stems from the exports of commodities that, benefiting from Ricardian rents, this is the cause behind, can be exported with a profit at an exchange rate substantially more appreciated than the one required for the other tradable firms that utilize technology in the old state of the art. So another way of defining the Dutch disease is to say the Dutch disease is a condition where there is two equilibriums, a current equilibrium that is defined by the commodities that the country exports, and an industrial equilibrium that is defined by the firms that utilize technology in the old state of the art. And they are different, these two lines. And the bigger the difference between these two lines, the more severe will be the Dutch disease. You can be, have a small Dutch disease, as is the case of Brazil or Argentina, where the Dutch disease originates from coffee in the past, now from soybeans, wheat, this kind of things. And you can have a very, very severe Dutch disease when it is it originates from oil, but not oil in countries where the oil cost is very low. Saudi Arabia, for instance, or the Emirates, where the cost of producing oil is very low, then you have enormous Ricardian rents, and then you, the Dutch disease in this case can be 90%, while in Brazil, 15, 20, normally. Varies. Okay? Não, aqui não. So, there is, this is the second model of the Dutch disease. The first model of the Dutch disease, it is expressed in these books in two papers in my site. But the first model of Dutch disease, also two papers by Corden and Neri, two distinguished neoclassical economists, but very good economists. You can be very good economist, be neoclassical. Very simple, you forget about neoclassical economics and then you and use your general theory of economics and your intelligence and experience and you do a good job, you can do a good job. Well, they have a model. I prefer much more mine, but you can see it. It's based, is a model that says that the Dutch disease only happens when there is booms of commodities. And they don't have disequilibriums, and they don't have also the way of neutralization that I explained to you. So, but anyway, it's important. It was the first, you know, to do that. And there are several, many papers, econometric papers trying to demonstrate there is a Dutch disease, what obviously exists. You don't need to, but, well, my beautiful graphic, it begins to be complicated. Now I have the Dutch disease. I have the current equilibrium, red. I have the industrial equilibrium above, brown. And the difference between both is the Dutch disease. This is time. Here is time. There is the exchange rate. And this was caused because the commodities can be exported with a profit, competitive with exchange rate, well, more appreciated than what's required by the others. The current equilibrium and the industrial equilibrium, now it becomes a very, very interesting. This is a general thing. Before this, one word about the Dutch disease yet. In 1989, I was invited to a conference in Tokyo. And in this conference was incredibly well organized conference with about 20 economists and many invited. And the conference was a comparison between Latin America and East Asia. And there was a subtitle between capital rich countries and, between natural resource rich countries and natural resource poor countries. And at that time, I think East Asia had already separated from, because till 1980, Brazil, Mexico, some other countries were growing and competing to a certain extent with the East Asian countries. Since 1980, We stopped it, and they continued. And they organized that this conference. It's funny because this was a kind of puzzle. Why? Because it was clear that the East Asian countries that don't have natural resources to use to export, they export manufactured goods, period. No? They have some, but not important. While Latin Americans, lots of natural resources, and the East Asian much more successful than us. That time I read, today, whew, the difference is huge, huge, huge. Nobody knew about what was the explanation. I don't remember of any paper. I have a beautiful book that was published. I should look more seriously there, but I remember hearing all the conference. No, no explanation. Now we have this explanation. Is it Dutch disease? They don't have Dutch disease. For them, it's much easier to have growth. We to grow, we have to neutralize the Dutch disease. When I was developing this model in 1906, 2007, in a given moment I stopped it because I said, well, Luiz Carlos, but you are speaking about the Dutch disease, developing this model, but Brazil for sure has Dutch disease, for sure. This is what I was making the theory, but for sure, Brazil has not a very serious, but has a Dutch disease, not a very severe. And we didn't know, we Brazilians, we didn't know that we had. And nevertheless, we had enormous growth. How can I explain this? And I stopped it for a short time. But in this short time appears Gabriel Palma, a friend of mine, a very an excellent Chilean economist that teaches at Cambridge. I asked him, I said, well, Gabriel, I'm with this problem. And he's a big man. And he said, but Luiz Carlos, in Latin America, didn't do any other thing than to neutralize the Dutch disease in that years, till 1980. When he said this phrase, I remember everything. I remember the several systems, especially the systems of multiple exchange rates that you use it, or the system of large import duties and large subsidies to export of manufactured goods. Well, then has two values. Ah, bom. Agora, now I'm entering the problem of the value of the exchange rate. In the case of the Dutch disease, we have two values. In any case, the foreign money has a value and a price. This is the phrase that's important here. You know that, I hope that you learned this somewhere, because in the neoclassicals, microeconomics, I believe that you didn't, but I know. You know that commodities and services have a value and a price. This was taught by us, by the classical economists. And the value corresponds essentially to labor incorporated in the production, or if you want, is the cost of production. And the price floats around the about the value according to demand and supply. This is basic classical economics for me. There is problems of the transformation of value and price that are very complicated, but this is not important. What's important that this we can only understand prices if you are able to distinguish value from price and to understand how value is important. Well, I say, and this is new, that the foreign money has also a value and a price. Uh, and the price floats around the value according to the demand and supply. What is the value of the exchange rate? Not very complicated when you put this, the question to you. What's the value of the exchange rate? It's very simple. instead of reading there, I read. But that, let me tell you a small story. When I wrote the first time the model of the Dutch disease, I said that the industrial equilibrium and thus the current equilibrium were necessary prices. Then when I was have to rewrite for the book or for this or for my class, I wanted to cut this necessary. Necessary prices. Prices are not necessary. Prices are prices. No? But then finally, I didn't cut. And this was, then 3 years ago, I went to Germany, to Berlin. And there I met an economist and had a long discussion with him. He's a post-Keynesian. He's a developmentalist. He had written a paper about the Dutch disease. And I began to tell him these ideas. He was very interested. And then in a certain moment, Jan Priv, his name, in a certain moment I said, well, and the way to neutralize the Dutch disease is by imposing, I will discuss this later, is by impose a tax on the exports of the commodity. Then my Jan said, no, there's no, no. Then I made a big argument, a big explanation, nothing. I offered him a graphic that I will show you, nothing. Then he came to Brazil. I again tried to persuade him, nothing. Then he back to Germany and sends me three pages, single space, demonstrating why I was wrong. I was thinking all the time. And why he was wrong and not me. But he helped me very much to develop this idea. Because he started from the assumption, this was assumption for him, that the exchange rate is defined by the demand and supply of foreign money, period. Well, if this is true, then a tax does not have an effect on the supply and demand of foreign money. Or he tried, in these three pages, he tried to find very ways of finding some relation between one thing and the other. And all the thing that he was able to find was very unimportant things. And so he concluded that I was wrong. And then it was in that moment that I realized that my necessary price was the value. And in the moment that I had the value, now, if the value is the cost of production, now a tax over the tax of production increases the value and neutralizes the Dutch disease. I will show you. But this is a story. No? Now, here the theory. The value of the foreign money is equal to the cost plus satisfactory profit or cost of production of the tradable firms that assure that the current account is balanced. This is the theory of the value, and this is the theory of the current account. Current account is the line of the value in several times for a country. And you saw red that this value is not fixed, it varies. So that the red line, you show again, she has some fluctuations. The value is this. It's the cost, while in the case of the industry, in the case of the Dutch disease, you have two values, because you have a value for the commodities, that is the current, and you have a value for the other tradable firms that use technology in the old state of the art. That is the value that covers the cost plus profit of these firms, competent firms. Well, so this definition is very, very simple. I always say that economics, when it's basic, is simple. Then you complicate, but basically it's simple. And you know for long that there is a relation between the value, between the exchange rate and the unit labor cost. But never people explain why and how. Now I have an explanation for this. What determines, what makes change, not determines, what makes change the value of the exchange rate? The comparative, the index, the comparative unit labor cost. What is the unit labor cost? The unit labor cost is cost divided by, is wages divided by productivity. This is unit labor cost. A comparative index of the unit labor cost is, everybody knows what I'm now saying, these two definitions, is you take, is a comparison between your currency and a basket of currencies of the firm, of the countries that you compete with. And so this comparative unit labor cost goes up and down, and this influences the value, makes the reason why that red line was not a line. When I began to teach this some years ago, the line was a line, straight line. It was a straight line. Now this line is like this, because these movements are due to the fact that the value changes as the comparative unit labor cost changes. Variations of the value or of the current equilibrium, how it varies. This is very interesting. Olha o que aconteceu lá com a minha coisa lá no. Isso já aconteceu num outro caso. Happily, it was only in that small file. Ah, sei. Enquanto a fonte é diferente, pode dar esse. Mas. Não tem importância aquilo lá. Variations of the value of the current equilibrium. Então, o current equilibrium, que é o valor, ele varies in time according to the international varies according to the international price of the commodity and secondarily to the comparative unit labor cost of the commodities. This is the normal current the normal the assumption is that the price of commodities varies a lot, while the corresponding comparative unit labor cost varies little. So what's important when you have Dutch disease, because when you have Dutch disease, the commodities that define the current equilibrium, and the non-commodities define the industrial equilibrium. And what determines essentially the current equilibrium, the equilibrium of the commodities, is the price of them, because they are very variable, the international price. While you can have also changes in the comparative unit labor cost of production of improves the production of oil in a country in relation to other countries, and then this that case, you have also an effect is. When the international commodity price, the international price of the commodities increase, or when the comparative unit labor cost increases, the value increases, or the line of the current equilibrium goes up, that red line, and the exchange rate falls or depreciates compensatorily to keep the current account balanced. So you learn now how this affects the equilibrium and the exchange rate. The exchange rate falls compensatorily. This is a very interesting thing. Normally, when you say we need to depreciate, Brazil had an enormous appreciation of the currency between 2006 and 2014, to the end of 2014. And I said, well, we need to depreciate. And the people, no, don't depreciate. What the industrialists have to do is to increase their productivity. This is a ridiculous explanation when the thing is big. When the thing is small, this is a good thing to say. No? Because if there is a small difference, of the best thing is to press the industrialists to be more productive. But when the difference is big, you have to depreciate. If you don't, you'll be in trouble, as we are in Brazil. There you can. Variations of the industrial. We saw the variations of the current equilibrium. Now, variations of the industrial equilibrium. The industrial equilibrium varies according to the comparative neoliberal cost, and secondly, according to the prices, terms of trade of the non-commodity tradable goods. Same thing, the other. But here, instead of commodities, I say the price of the non-commodity tradable goods. The assumption is that the price of the non-commodity tradable goods and services very little. Their term trades are relatively constant. What's important is the comparative unit labor costs, that this changes. And when this changes in Brazil, for instance, in the last 10 years, there was a substantial increase in the comparative unit labor costs. Wages increased more than productivity. And this made the Dutch disease more severe. Muito bem. Look that the industrial equilibrium does not determine the exchange rate. What determines the exchange rate is the current equilibrium, not industrial. How long it took me to come to this? What determines the exchange rate price? When there is not Dutch disease, the value of the foreign money, which varies with the currency. When there is a Dutch disease, the international price of the commodity and here's wrong. The international price of the commodity and the culture also, both, for sure. Now, the end here. And from this is about the value. The exchange rate is divided by the value and then by the demand and supply around this value. What determines the demand or supply of foreign money? First, I say the textbook variables that you find in the textbooks. Interest rate differences, terms of trade, capital inflows or outflows, confidence existing in the government or the country, existence or not of capital controls, etc. These are things that you learn, and they are important. There is a classical observation that comes all the time. Well, but where are the capital flows? They are here. But the capital flows, they are very important. You are not giving the importance that they have. I am not. Definitely, I am not. Why? Because they don't give you any theory, and they have no direction, and they normally annihilate one or the other. But you can have bubbles. You can have moments of a currency, speculative attacks. Well, for sure you can have. But you have speculative attacks when the country is feeble. When you have enormous current account debts and you have a big foreign debt. then you became feeble, you can be attacked by and the crisis, the clashes. But if not, they are not so important. Anyway, they are trouble, they are a problem for us. Okay, they are a problem. Well, these are the demand, the textbook variables. And what is new here is, I already talked this in the beginning, the three habitual policies which systematically appreciate the national currency of the developing country. Which are these three habitual policies? First, before saying this, look just one thing. In all this, and this was important now when I speak up, especially about the first policy. Which is the relation between the exchange rate and the current account? There is an inverse and the linear relation between both for each moment. It is this graphic here. Well, this is the exchange rate, and this is the, well, the next, where is the current account deficit? Only two. Como é que é? Isso aqui é a conta corrente. É. E aqui, então, é a taxa de câmbio. Então, é isso mesmo. Então, isso é a linha. Agora, nós já vimos que essa linha, quer dizer, mas isso corresponde a um momento. I'm sorry. Ela estava entendendo. But look, this line is for one moment. And you saw that the line of the current equilibrium is floating. Not floating, changing. Changes because when there is changes, what happens? Is when this line shifts down or up. And this shift is that explains the movements of the in time of the current equilibrium. This is important because all this theory, the first intuition that I had, I was in a conference in Rio de Janeiro, and an economist said something about the exchange rate, I don't remember what. And suddenly I had, and I knew very well that during the Cardoso administration, from which I participated, but not in the economic area, I was Minister of Public Administration, and that later on of Science and Technology for a few months. And I knew that the Cardoso administration had been characterized by a strong policy of growth with foreign savings. Or foreign savings means current account deficits. And I suddenly realized that when Cardoso and his team decided to have high current account deficits to grow with foreign savings, what they were doing was appreciating the currency. So I have the intuition of this line. And everything began from this, then through the years. But it's important so that you have an idea of what I'm speaking. So, before the policies, we have still the Dutch disease. The severity of the Dutch disease, it's equal to the distance between the current and the industrial equilibrium, right? And you can have at this percentage. Very simple, no complications. Neutralization, this is important. An export tax equal to the severity of the Dutch disease will neutralize it, making the current and the industrial equilibrium equal. Why? I already explained to you why. Because the cost of production, or the value of the exchange rate, when you put a tax over it, this cost increases. If this tax is equal to the severity of the Dutch disease, the two equilibriums became the same, and the Dutch disease is neutralized. But there is another explanation, more elegant. This is more fundamental. And more elegant because you can put in a graphic. Now, let me show you, then I'll be back. You can, the neutralization of the Dutch disease can be shown also by the classical Marshallian graphic. You have the exchange rate in the ordinate, not anymore time, but quantity here, and you have the supply of the commodity. Let's say soybeans, the only commodity that Brazil exports, or country exports. This is, and you have a demand, and demand is fully inelastic in relation to the exchange rate, for sure. And the international price is given. So you have the equilibrium there, Q1. Then you put a tax, yeah? And this tax, according to your Marshallian microeconomics, shifts the supply curve to the left, and you have the new equilibrium, and after this small movement, and again, the exchange rate, the Dutch disease was neutralized. This is the only thing that I'm going to speak about Brazil in this session, in this class. This is, here, I'm telling all these things to you, but this can be transformed in numbers, and very simple numbers. Então, I have the current equilibrium, the industrial equilibrium, the exchange rate in real terms, but the price, the exchange rate is the price, the severity of the Dutch disease, and the overvaluation existing. And I took, it's inverse, 206.14. And today. No? And look, before looking at the table, read here. Since 2010, the current, the comparative wage labor cost index increased substantially, increasing the industrial equilibrium from 340 to 360. The second line, 340 to 360. In the second semester of 2004, sharp fall in the price of commodities spotted, increasing the current equilibrium from 290 to 350. Approximately, all these figures are very approximated. In the exchange rate, in this period, was around 260, 250, 260, in real, in today prices, all real today prices. And today, yesterday at least, was 390. After this big depreciation that happened, well, then you can calculate the severity of the Dutch disease. The severity of Dutch disease was 17%, and today, zero, practically. 0.3, if you want. Very small. Why? But the overvaluation. The overvaluation is different. It's 24%, and at that time, and today, is minus, the minus is, they inverted also the, it's, everything is inverted, the numbers. It's minus 1%, not more 1%. There is no overvaluation. The industrial equilibrium is 360, and the exchange rate is 390. You have not an overvaluation, but you have devalued currency. devalued currency in this 3 reais, 3 cents per dollar. Okay? Then you could, I'm speaking all the time. Then you have, I sit and you make questions. Okay. Well, I already said a neutralization of the Dutch disease, a variable spot tax equal to the severity of the Dutch disease, you neutralize it. because it increases the value, because it shifts the supply curve. In the example, and I have this example. Remember that I told you that you had three equilibriums. The third equilibrium is really a false equilibrium. It's not equilibrium. Or it is equilibrium for the neoclassical economists, or for the orthodox economists, and for the dumb developmentalist economists. Is what I call the foreign debt equilibrium. And what is the foreign debt equilibrium? Is the exchange rate, it corresponds to exchange rate that produces a current account deficit, which is consistent with maintaining the foreign debt GDP ratio constant. Or in other words, the foreign debt equilibrium is the exchange rate that corresponds to a current account deficit in relation to the GDP equal to the rate of growth of GDP. This is a simple thing, but the important is this concept. This concept corresponds loosely to what John Williamson calls the fundamental exchange rate. And they have it. And look, the difference is that he and the economists in general recommends it, this fundamental equilibrium, while I reject it. Obviously, what I'm proposing is that countries have follow the competitive equilibrium, that's the industrial equilibrium. There's a huge difference in the recommended exchange rates. For the developmentalism is the industrial equilibrium. For the orthodox and populists, the foreign debt equilibrium. Populists also here. Everybody in your countries, including Brazil, I know at least two here that are Brazilians, we liked a current account deficit. Current deficit is a good thing. Makes the exchange rate appreciated, makes everything cheaper for us, makes travels much better, etc., etc. It's a wonderful thing. Yeah. So populists like very much, besides Mr. Williamson and all the and Washington, besides Williamson and Washington, yeah. The country that has a Dutch disease and accepts the Fed, the foreign debt equilibrium is condemned to export commodities because its price will be wrong. The exchange rate will be overvalued, the expected profit rate will be depressed, our revenues will be artificially high. And here, then you have the complete, the last graphic. Now I have also the yellow line. This is the foreign debt equilibrium. So the difference is that what I'm suggesting you that if your country wants to develop, if you want to follow what Brazil did between 1950 and 80, and or what East Asia does all the time, is to grow floating the exchange rate around the industrial equilibrium. What the economists propose to us is the yellow line. What we do is worse than that. Look, one thing that I didn't explain, but I explained that in a moment. Look, there is a difference between the severity and the overvaluation. Why? Because the in the overevaluation, there is the Dutch disease, but there is also the three, the other factors, or at least the three habitual policies that appreciated the currency. So in this case, the current equilibrium was 290, but the exchange rate was at 260. The difference between 90 and 60, this 30, this was caused by other things that than the Dutch disease, obviously. And what well, just one slide about this. Financial crisis and thus financialization are in the core of new developmentalism. In this book, we have a chapter on financial crisis. Financial crises are explained by the policy of growth with foreign debt, of foreign savings, or the policy of growth with foreign debtness, same thing, and not essentially explained by budget deficits, because what the Orthodox tell us is that our problem is always the budget deficit and only the budget deficit. You know, look, that I consider populism not to be severe in terms of budget deficit. But what I'm telling you in relation to this is that it's not the budget deficit, but the policy of growth with foreign savings that caused the financial crisis. They come together, especially when you have the twin deficits system. But they are not necessarily equal. We saw this in Europe, for instance, recently. We saw this in many places, that they are, the twin deficits not always holds. So this is the cause of the essential cause are the policy of growth with foreign savings or foreign indebtedness. They are cyclical currency crises. They erupt when the foreign creditors in foreign money lose the confidence and stop rolling over the debt. They suppose a financial bubble, which explains why the exchange rate remains for years at a level that corresponds to a current account deficit superior to the foreign debt equilibrium. Remember in our graph, our last graph, you can see this. Where is this? Ai. Para no mundo. Look, this line here. I always working with floating exchange rate all the time. Market, all the time, market. Economics is the science of markets, remember. With a floating exchange rate, what the theory tells us is that the exchange rate will float always around the equilibrium, and whenever begins to have some current account deficit, it is eliminated because the exchange rate depreciates and the thing works. Oh, not true. No. But to have this, I need a bubble. I need that the foreign creditors are very happy and of making loans to the developing country and continue to do so. And the multinationals are happier investing, the wonderful multinationals, etc. Exchange rate policy. It will have to proceed. The exchange rate policy, you have to proceed two neutralizations. One, the Dutch disease. And second, the tendency to the overvaluation of the exchange rate. So you have to neutralize the Dutch disease by the tax, but you have to neutralize also the fact that appreciate the currency arbitrarily, that I'm going to discuss still, the three policies. And to neutralize this tendency to the overvaluation, besides neutralizing the Dutch disease, you have to reject the three habitual policies: the growth with foreign borrowing or foreign savings, the high level of interest rate, and the exchange rate anchor policy to control inflation. And you should control capital inflows when needed. But I have to explain here these three things. Before that, some economic consequences of the exchange rate policy: a satisfactory rate of profit, because the exchange rate will be competitive, you have a satisfactory rate of profit for the good firms in the country. A reduction of the short-term consumption, because wages, and not only wages, and all other revenues from interest, from profits, dividends, rent, all falls in real terms. So a short-term reduction in consumption, increase in the investment rate, current account surplus. This is very strange. Thus, the why current account surplus? I don't know if I'm going to explain this. Again, our graphic. Look, to neutralize, when I neutralized the Dutch disease, I made the industrial equilibrium equal to the current. Going up, not going down, going up. Going up to the industrial equilibrium with the exchange rate. Okay? Well, if the current equilibrium is the current equilibrium, if the current equilibrium balances intertemporally the current account of the country, when you go to the industrial equilibrium, you necessarily have a current account surplus. So countries that have the Dutch disease and neutralize it don't need foreign capitals. They may need foreign multinationals because of technology and because of markets, but they don't need the capitals of the rich countries. This is a very counterintuitive conclusion, but it's fundamental. And I see no, it's not by accident that these Asian countries that don't have Dutch disease, they normally have surpluses. The country that most developed in the whole history of mankind, that was in a period of 30 years, that was China, has always current account surpluses, so don't need at all money, foreign money. They are investing abroad. The other countries are becoming indebted to them and not in the reverse. It's a kind of surprising thing, because how Eichengreen, I remember in a footnote, said once, it's natural that capital-rich countries, for sure, are supposed to transfer their capitals for capital-poor countries. I'm telling, well, all right, this is true, so true as the Earth is flat. The Earth seems to be flat, but it's not. We seem to need foreign capitals, but we don't need. When we adopt foreign capitals, we don't grow more, we grow less. This is one explanation, and the other explanation, but there is another explanation. Well, and you have to reject the three policies. Now I'm going to discuss these policies. Rejecting the growth with foreign borrowing policy, or rejecting the policy of growth with foreign savings, same thing. Yes. Ah, eu estou outra vez com dinheiro aqui, não. Eu não sei o que está acontecendo. You have to reject the growth with foreign savings, because generally foreign savings don't add to domestic savings. This is very important. Look, when you go to accounting, economic accounting, total savings are equal foreign domestic savings plus foreign savings, okay? So what I'm telling you that this is in accounting, not in economics. In economics, the foreign savings don't add to domestic savings, but replace them. There is a high rate of substitution of foreign for domestic savings. And the consequence, and in consequence, all that money that's coming from abroad, it goes most of it to consumption and not to investment. Why there is this high rate of substitution of foreign for domestic savings? Why the accounting does not work economically? There is a very simple reason. It's because when you decide to grow with foreign savings, you are deciding, remember that relation between the current account deficit and the exchange rate, when you decide to grow with foreign savings, with foreign indebtedness, you are deciding to appreciate your currency. When you appreciate your currency, what happens? You are discouraging investment. What happened to the, I spoke about the, why the exchange rate was essential in the investment rate. No, that in the beginning of the course. I think that this I skipped this. Oh, one second before I explain this. Look, remember when the slide is very, in the beginning. I speak of the investment function. When I spoke about the investment function, I said that, the classical said that the investment depends on the expected profit rate and the cost of capital. Then that Keynes said, well, okay, but you need to have in consideration the demand. That's not a guarantee. And then I say, okay, but for us, you have to consider the exchange rate because it's the exchange rate that guarantees the access to demand. I said this. So the exchange rate is in the production function when you have the, what I told you already, now you know well, this tendency to the overvaluation of the exchange rate in the long term. So when I to have a competitive exchange rate is absolutely fundamental for investment. When you don't have, you have two conditions in relation to this, and that disease, that's not the only cause, but is an important cause for overvaluation. If you never industrialized, and you have that disease, and you don't neutralize it, you never industrialize, period. This is Saudi Arabia. This is Peru. If you industrialize it, you certainly did that because you neutralized it for some time. And then when you stop neutralizing it, we stopped in Brazil, we stopped neutralizing that disease in 1990. Exactly in this year, without knowing. That moment we began to deindustrialize because investment in the manufacturing industry begins to slow down. So the cause of this, the first cause is simply this. The first cause why there is a high rate of substitution is that the exchange rate appreciates, and the exchange rate appreciates disencourages investment. The second reason is on this demand side, on the revenue side. When you appreciate the the currency, the revenues of people, wages and other revenues increase. They have a high propensity to consume, a marginal propensity to consume. They consume more, and the savings replace the foreign savings replace the domestic savings instead of adding to it. These are the two explanations from us. And both are very simple and have the same result. Does this mean that this high rate of subsidization always happens? No. There are cases when this rate of substitution is not very high. Especially when you are in a miracle, when the country is already growing very fast. Because when the country is growing very fast, the propensity to consume falls. Because everybody wants to invest. Because the profit rate, the expected profit rate became too high. For that reason, everybody's investing. Because everybody invests, the country is growing. And so in this moment, the rate of substitution falls. And in this moment, foreign savings can help. But this the last time that's happened in Brazil is in the 70s, early 70s. Okay. Finishing. What about the distribution? Oh, I didn't speak a word about the other two causes, the other two habitual policies, the policy of level of the interest rate. If you have a high level of interest rate, it attracts capital. Why they use a high level of interest rate? They say in Brazil and the other countries because it will have to attract capital or because you have to control inflation. But why don't you can't you control inflation moving the exchange the interest rate around 1 or 2% real terms instead of 5%? It was bigger before. No response. So this is one thing. The other thing is to reject the policy of exchange rate anchor. This is a very bad thing. But this is a thing that central banks very much like to do. They say that what makes them to control inflation is to increase the interest rate. And this resolves the problem. Not true. They count with this, for sure, but they count extremely with the appreciation of the currency. That's a very strong way of controlling inflation. And what this theory says is no use. Want to control inflation? Okay, you control inflation with monetary policy and with fiscal policy. Oh, but these are the not nice things. These are costly. Well, what can I say? We need low inflation. We have to control this in a reasonable way. Our only objective is not to control inflation. We have to control inflation. We have to have growth. We have to have distribution. We have several objectives. But what I cannot do is to control inflation with an exchange rate anchor. This is pure populism. So this now, what about distribution? In Brazil, there are people that said, "Well, this new development is not very, very good." No, this is we need this is a little conservative. What we need is a social developmentalism. I am for a social developmentalism immediately. But look, speaking seriously, I told you in the beginning about vulgar or populist Keynesianism, vulgar or populist developmentalism. And I said that the neoclassical economists are very strong in exchange rate populism. They are good in that. No? So, So what I'm saying, in other words, is that macroeconomic policy was not created, does not exist to promote distribution. When you read the newspapers, what you see all everywhere in the world is a big fight between the, here in France, for instance, between the Orthodox and the Keynesians, because ones are for austerity, the others against austerity. Well, in some degrees, okay, that you have this. But the fact is that macroeconomic policy was created to assure full employment. And so to assure growth. Macroeconomic policy exists to have the five macroeconomic price right. That this will give you the full employment or the growth if you have. The only thing that really has an important role, a certain role in distribution, is the policy on the interest rate. What they have been saying all the time, that the level of the interest rate should be low, yes. Because the interest rate remunerates essentially the rentier capitalists. And all this model, if I was to discuss this in political terms, says that this developmentalist strategy is done for the entrepreneur capitalists and not for rentier capitalists. The rentier capitalists and the financier are the adversary, not the associates. Well, so I am not in favor of using exchange rate, of using, for instance, to use the exchange rate for distribution is ridiculous. That's the word. It's ridiculous. Because you are lowering wages. Okay, but you are lowering, when you depreciate, you are lowering wages. But you are lowering wages, and you are lowering dividends, you are lowering rents of real estate, and you are lowering interests received. Everybody is having their revenues reduced. And you have tragical consequences in terms of growth, in terms of crisis, etc. So it's ridiculous. Then what are the real distributive policies? The real distributive policies are minimum wage. This is essential when there is room for that. In France, there is no room for minimum wage. You have already a good, but in Germany there was. Now they are increasing. Second, absolutely important, the welfare state. Social, the large social and scientific services of the modern state. This is very important. The existence, for instance, of a universal health system is of enormous importance for distribution. Third, progressive taxation. These people that's always this populist that are all the time discussing about social developmentalism and, and things like that, they forget entirely progressive taxation. Because they pay the progressive taxation probably. Everybody, the middle class begins to pay the so one graph, one table about this. Consequence of depreciation on wages. This line here, that fall here, there's no reason. That's a mistake. But what this is showing? This is showing a theoretical example. The wage rate, that is in the ordinate, is increasing in real terms. Then comes a depreciation. Then it falls. And then it begins again to increase, but increases with a different slope. And in few time, you are already having a larger wage rate. And growth, the only reason for growth is to increase wage rates. We don't are favorable growth for any other reason besides this. Second, about the distribution and the progressive tax rate. I put three countries here. Sweden, that you know is a very more equal country, a very equal country. Denmark is better, but I didn't have Denmark. After and before and after taxes. And look what happens. Look, only Sweden and United States. Germany is in the middle. Before taxes, the difference is very small, 49 versus 46. Gini, 0.46, 0.4, very small, very difference, very small difference. After taxes, the difference is enormous. And this is are these taxes that make the United States the more unequal of rich countries, and makes Sweden one of the more equal of rich countries. So we have discussed these three things instead of discussing the exchange rate. When you discuss distribution. Well, to conclude, main differences in relation to classical developmentalism and post-Keynesian macro. Well, this is a kind of, remember, it's focused on the five macroeconomic prices, it's focused on the exchange rate, the current account deficit, and the expected profit rate. It is based on the tendency of the overvaluation. Its investment function includes the exchange rate, which tends to not give access to demand, if left free, has a new model of the Dutch disease, rejects growth with foreign savings, defends an active exchange rate policy, defends a manufactured goods export-led strategy. This last thing I didn't. Only this last thing, I didn't say one word, the export-led. Well, a big discussion also among progressives and conservative. The conservatives are supposed to be for export-led, while the progressives are supposed to be for domestic-led. This is ridiculous to myself. For some time I have my doubts, but today I am fully persuaded. All experience tells us that growth is associated with a export-led strategy. The only condition you can only do not have a export-led strategy when you have an import substitution strategy. And an import substitution strategy is a good strategy for the beginning of industrialization, never for a middle-income country that already has a good industry, manufacturing industry. Besides that, one of the things that more interests the post-Keynesian economists is the Thirlwall law. I hope that you have learned things about the Thirlwall law. It's a nice thing. It is, I could have put here, because it is the formalization of a Prebisch's foreign restriction, or two elasticities issue. What is interesting in this Prebisch-Thirlwall thing, that's essential, these two elasticities, is the following. It becomes very clear from the law. The law is a kind of reasoning, axiomatic reasoning. But it's very important, because it shows you that normally, the growth of the country has to be smaller than the growth of the of exports. This comes from the formula directly. So if you want to grow fast, you have to grow exports, not parts of commodities for sure, preferably exports of manufactured goods, but you have to grow. It's obvious. So experience shows us, all the East Asian countries have a professor that's a specialist in this country. He can tell you that they use a spot-led strategy. We have to use also a spot-led strategy. Brazil, for instance, had an enormous spot-led strategy between 1967 and 1990, and was extremely successful. Okay, thank you. Now.
Thank you, Professor Bresser. We are with a we're facing a time problem here, so I'll try to speed it up a little bit. And we won't try to repeat what he just said, but instead to introduce a more practical discussion and make some and raise some points for debate. So the structure of the presentation goes as it follows. First, we will present some context about the revival of the developmentalist discussion on the 2000s. And then we will present what we think is the important contribution of neo-developmentalism, which is to serve as a tool to discuss some contemporary problems developing economies today, especially Latin America. And for this, we will oppose neo-developmentalism and social developmentalism, which we think are the two main frameworks of discussion today in Latin America. And under the hypothesis that many of these countries follow the social developmentalist strategy, in the sense that they focus more on the internal market for growth, we will analyze possible flaws of this model from a neo-developmentalist perspective. And for last, we will raise some points for discussion. So in the 80s and 90s, as many countries, Latin America suffered from a neoliberalist phase, but the slow growth, poverty, inequality kind of opened space for a revival of the developmentalist thinking with the rise in the 2000s of many left-oriented governments with the proposal of growth and redistribution at the same time, with an active role of the state for it. So the growth with redistribution project in Latin America, we understand as being developmentalist in the sense that it calls for structural changes and sees the states as a structural crucial actor to promote them. But however, there are some very different strategies on how this could be achieved. And in that sense, neo-developmentalism and social developmentalism are kind of the guiding frameworks for the contemporary debate today in Latin America. So there are two very different proposals, but they operate in separate dimensions. They can't be confused, because neo-developmentalism is an organized theory that pledges for its export-led growth, where a competitive exchange rate would boost industrial competitiveness. This will lead to structural changes in the economy. Whereas social developmentalism is not proper a theory, but kind of a mindset, a set of policies that were developed during these left-oriented governments, and often they don't call themselves social developmentalist. It's still kind of a category. But they think about the internal market as the main drive for growth and redistribution. And this will be promoted with a virtual cycle of growth that I will explain very quickly. Rising wages, credit, public transfers, and public investment will boost aggregate demand. This will lead to a rise in investment and productivity, leading to growth and, at the same time, reduction of inequality. And this will engender could reproduce the cycle. So in the 2000s, we have seen the spread of many policies in LA focused on the expansion of the domestic market. And initially, we have seen some good results in terms of growth and reduction of income inequality. However, from a historical point of view, apparently these outcomes were not very sustainable, because we had some, in a historical perspective, there was a modest expansion of the GDP, low or even negative in sometimes growth of productivity, limited technological advances, and it's important, Bertolet Campo shows that there has been no convergence of per capita GDP with advanced countries. As put by Elena Lavinas, in prioritizing the domestic market as the central engine for development, this model lost steam, trapped in a spiral within which investment and productivity gains failed to jive according to the weighted script. So, how could neo-developmentalist framework help us to explain or trying to understand a little bit of what could have happened? Well, some insights is because these policies were often practiced along with an overappreciated currency related to commodities boom and populist policies, and also with high interest rates or high external financing. And this, in the now developmentalist theory, would reduce industrial competitiveness and therefore leading to an unsustainable path of development. So we will show Brazil as an example of how these dimensions could be somehow interrelated. Brazil, in the last decade, we have some very, very big growth of income indicators like minimum wage, monetary transfers, and this was related to a reduction in income inequality, but also allowed for a big expansion of the domestic market. But at the same time, we lack sustainable outcomes in terms of GDP, gross capital investments, and productivity. Although there was a good initial results, now the average rate of growth is kind of what was back in the end of the 90s. And at the same time, we suffer from a very substantial overappreciation of our exchange rate that passed from 4 reais per dollar in 2002 to 1.5 reais per dollar in 2011. And our exchange rates were always one of the highest of the world. This is a comparison from World Bank data of Brazil and the other countries from BRICS to see what I'm talking about. And so now developmentalist predictions seems to be on the consequence of this kind of policy of exchange and interest rates seem to be accurate in the sense that we indeed lost a very serious loss of industrial competitiveness. Our industrial goods were 57% of our total exports in 2000s, but only 37% in 2013. And in these 13 years, the participation of manufacturing industry on GDP fell 25%. So this could explain a lot about our poor performance on GDP investments and productivity. And also the last remark is that the appreciation of the currency also, for some other authors, have an important role in the leaking of these potential gains of the internal market because people started to buy imports and not a national production. So, and this is a trade balance to see that we have the trade balance has been deteriorating and we have been continuously being more dependent on commodities and low-tech products. So, okay, some flaws of these recent policies could be predicted by the neo-developmentalist approach. However, it is more than just a critique of exchange rates and interest rates. And although addressing some crucial points, we have also it has also raised some debates on the academic community, especially regarding export-led growth model and redistribution. And Thereza is going to talk about them now.
So I'm going to explain some points that we thought while reading the paper. The first one is related to what he explained shortly about devaluation in current account. We agreed that devaluation would probably would make a current account surplus. However, sometimes the Marshall Hellman condition doesn't apply to some countries. For instance, in the case of Brazil, the Marshall Hellman condition is explained by Krugman by all as equal. A real depreciation improves the current account if export and import volumes are sufficient elastic with respect to the real exchange rate. Some papers, such the ones that we mentioned in our presentation, they make estimations and they see that some countries, such as Brazil, they don't fit in this condition, which means that in this case, a devaluation of the currency would actually worsen the current account of the country, and thus probably causing a foreign indebtedness because they would have a shortage of. They would have to pay with foreign currency. Therefore, we would like to show a simple scheme that we did. What would happen in this case when this condition doesn't hold? If you have devaluation, the nominal value for imports would increase. Therefore, the change of the value for imports would be bigger than the exports, and this would perhaps cause inflation. Because the prices of imports would be larger, so all the other prices in the retail, for instance, would have to increase as well. And considering that the foreign demand would stay in the same level, that would reduce the current account in the end. We think that, for instance, in the exchange rate policies in the neo-developmentalism theory, it should also be mentioned that industrial policy should have to be a priority, since the manufactured goods have a higher income elasticity than commodities. Therefore, being able to reduce balance of payment constraints in the end. we thought about maybe explaining how research and development policies should have more importance in the country as well, since it will make the country able to produce more high technology goods, and therefore also increase international competitiveness. And in the case of Brazil, we would just like mention how inflation could also be approached, since trying to control inflation with exchange rates is not a viable solution. We cite a paper from two professors from Rio, where they say that inflation in Brazil, for instance, should be controlled by via costs, which means that should be controlled via costs. Which means that by reducing, not reducing wages, but making wages aligned with productivity, and also reducing the monetary prices that we have, which means prices that are administrated by the state. This could also reduce inflation overall, so we wouldn't have to use the exchange rate, for instance, neither increasing so much the interest rate to try to lower inflation. And the final point, I'll try to be fast. We would also like to just comment that this idea of increasing profits to promote investment, thus growth, it also can cause a very high risk of diminishing the bottom, the part of the bottom of incomes of the country, and promote more reconcentration of income. Therefore, we would like to try to make it more clear that those projects of redistribution, for instance, minimum wage policies or increasing social goods, it also requires a very strong political power, because the rich they have much more power than workers, which means that they would not easily accept this tax reform, and so it should also be taken into consideration. And I think that's it. And we have only actually one question, which is, we would like to know your opinion about this new policy in Brazil. If you think that is a reasonable policy of exchange rate, the sharp devaluation that we had last year. And if you think that, for instance, other policies should be taken into consideration as well to improve growth. Okay, that's it. Thanks.
Okay. So I first answer the two ladies, and then which is your name?
Anna.
Anna. I have a granddaughter, Anna. And you?
Thereza.
I have a daughter. Daughter, no. I have a sister. Okay. Well, Dona Ana and Dona Thereza. First, about social developmentalism. I became very unhappy, profoundly unhappy, when I began. I look persons saying, "Oh, let's compare this." The last time that happened was with Barbara Fritz, not with this paper. I didn't read this paper of hers with Lina Lavinia. But 2 weeks ago, the last thing I did in Brazil, 3 weeks ago, there was a conference in Unicamp that was organized by the Institute of America Latina of Berlin and Unicamp on developmentalisms. And Barbara Fritz, plus two Brazilian economists, wrote the basic paper for the. I was supposed to make the keynote speech. Another guy from the Unicamp would make another. Well, and look, I think that when you compare things, we are supposed to compare similar things. When you compare potatoes with suits, it makes no sense. No? And it's more or less like this. I'm exaggerating, but it's more or less like this. Because new developmentalism is a theory. And then you can use this theory, and you have some openings for policy. But it's a theory first. And it's a new theory, really new. While this is just populism. Just populism. Having nothing new, old ideas, vulgar Keynesianism. So, and I told this to Barbara. And should not, and she agreed. And said, and after the, was I made my keynote speak. Then came the young guy from Campinas that did his. They invented the social developmentalism, and it was ridiculous. One thing was okay. Sport-led. This is I already told about a few words about this. But look. This discussion is a discussion that comes from the old time, from the 60s, 70s. I remember very well this discussion in the 60s and 70s. 60s, I'm not sure. And spot-led would be conservative. I tell you, the only way to have, there is a paper. There is a paper by Baduri and Marglin in the Cambridge Journal of Economics, it's a 1990 paper, that is used normally to the people that defends spot-led. Actually, they don't use spot-led, they use profit-led. Profit-led and wage-led. I know very well Baduri, not Marglin. They are both Marxists. I like Marxists. I'm not Marxist, but I like Marxists. But they do a nice paper. But if you read carefully the paper, you see that domestic-led growth or wage-led growth, domestic wage-led growth, depends on very high tariffs on imports. Or in other words, depends on import substitution. Look what happened in Brazil in the 2000s. In the 2000s, when Lula arrived to government, he arrived with a crisis, with an exchange rate that was around, at today price, near 7 reais per dollar. And in today price, he left to Dilma an impossible mission. He left the exchange rate at 2.2 reais maximum, 7 to 2.2, when the competitive exchange rate, the equilibrium, was $3.30 per dollar. She left 2.20. She had to make 50% depreciation to regain competitiveness. This is only a mission that Tom Cruise was capable of doing, not our president. But what happened in the 2000s? He came with this enormous appreciation all the time, using exchange rate anchor to control inflation. This, the central bank controlled by a very orthodox economist, but with the support of the heterodox, so not in directly, but. And the growth doubled. Instead of 1%, 2% per capita, to a little more. Why? Only for one reason, a commodity boom. The price of commodities bought by Brazil were more than doubled, three times bigger, about three times bigger. So this was, had no a basis for this. And had another basis, so that the disaster happened before the fall of the commodity price. The commodity price only fall in the second semester of last year. And the economy is falling very low since this year, since 2011. Why? Because what happened in the Lula government is that what happened to the industrialists. In the beginning, they had a very, very attractive exchange rate, and they returned to exporting. And the exports of manufactured goods increased strongly in Brazil. And Brazil had a current account surplus for a few years. But the exchange rate continued to appreciate, given the tendency to the, in a given moment, the industrialists could not anymore export. But the domestic market had increased, not only because the GDP had increased, but also because wages had increased with the minimum wage. Was a very good thing that he made, to increase in real terms 50% the real wages, because credit increased, consumer credit, because the Bolsa Família also helped. So the industrialists lost the foreign market, but gained the domestic market, and then the social developmentists were happy. I looked to them and said, you are a fool. I publishing a book called The Macroeconomics of Stagnation in Brazil, and they happy. What happened? To import manufactured goods, businessmen normally need 3 years in average. It's different from importing commodities, because commodities, you look the price in the Chicago bourse and you import, finished, one day. But manufactured goods, a long process. So when Dilma was in office, in this moment, the importers were red, the country was flooded with the imported goods, and the industrialists that had lost the foreign markets lost also the domestic markets. The growth with foreign wages, the domestic-led strategy or the wage-led strategy had failed, obviously, necessarily. Marshall Lerner. Look, sometimes I become very unhappy with the economists. Is when the economists forgot that they are economists, and they forgot that there is the law of demand and supply. That prices are determined by demand and supply. Suddenly, exports, imports are not anymore determined by the exchange rate and its price that controls them, but for some other thing. Well, obviously there is cases for this. Specific cases for some moments. I can imagine, for instance, a situation where a devaluation for a country that exports only commodities. You don't need, in principle, unless these commodities are, because the commodities are not elastic in relation to this part of commodities, in the short term at least, are not elastic to. But this is exception, real exception. Normally, yes, the exchange rate has a major effect on exports and imports. Another thing. The exchange rate is politically internationally, it's a forbidden price. I don't know if today continues, but till some years ago, when you entered the World Bank, you were informed, here we don't discuss the interest rate, the exchange rate. Finished. In the WTO, it's forbidden to speak about the exchange rate. I have a friend of mine that learned with me these basics, and there is a very active person in the WTO. It's creating a big fuss about this in the last 2 years, 3 years. But it's forbidden. Because why? Because the exchange rates are very powerful price. And if the developing countries began to use this, the fundamental, they began to have trade surplus, and this does not interest the rich countries, whatever. And this does not interest to the financiers domestically that are associated with the North and the rentier capitalists. Industrial policy. The last paper that I finished, is I just finished with a young man that just finished his PhD in the new school. It's called Fernando Rujitsky. I'm going to present the paper in Berlin in two weeks with him. He will go and present, I go. And the idea of the paper is the following. We don't have anything against industrial policy. On the contrary, in all my life, I always supported industrial policy. But I think that industrial policy has been hugely overestimated. Why? What happened? What happened is that in the 40s, the classical developmentalism emerged with Rosenstein, Rodin, and the others after him. And there was some theory, but the theory of classical developmentalism was a critique of the neoclassical comparative advantages based on the Prebisch Singer law. Towards this foreign constraint thing based on the two elasticities was the conclusion that industrialization was necessary. Some Keynesian's ideas together, and that was all. It was not a very much sophisticated theory. But what's worse is that since the 70s, since the mid-60s, no more contributions to it. Nothing. Finished. It finished with the, who killed the classical developmentalism was first the associated dependency theory. And second was neoclassical economics that turned dominant in the early 80s. Then, what happened in the camp of heterodox economists? In 1982, Chalmers Johnson published a very interesting book about Japan, the MITI, and how industrial policy had a fundamental important. MITI is the Ministry of Industrial Commerce in Japan. In 1989, Alice Amsden published a fascinating book about Korea, South Korea, showing how industrial policy was very important. And the next year, Robert Wade published a book on Taiwan, showing the same thing. Then, I think that the classical developmentalism, today's social developmentalists, they expired. Now you have something. What they had? Industrial policy. Well, industrial policy is something very pragmatic. You know that the market's not fully right, and you have to act in certain moments strategically, this and that. What was the problem about all this? What was the problem of these three books? Specifically, these three books. What was the problem? The problem with these three books, and they didn't take into consideration that the macroeconomics of these three countries were essentially, fundamentally, new developmentalist macroeconomics. The five macroeconomic prices were fully right. The exchange rate was right, the expected profit rate was right, the wage rate was right, the interest rate was right, very low, the inflation rate was right, very low. The five, they were absolutely, and they were responsible in fiscal terms, no adventures in fiscal terms, no current account debts at all ever. No, no, no. Small ones, and then, okay. So with this, what happened in Brazil is that they wanted to replace industrial policy with, replace macroeconomic equilibrium with industrial policy. It was a disaster. In the last year and a half of the Dilma administration, she made a big mistake. Her big mistake was an enormous industrial policy, the desoneration of taxes in wage expenditures. Terrible, disastrous policy that she adopted. Typical social developmentalist policy, or populist policy. Industrial policy, inflation, I am not going to discuss that. I discussed for 14 years, Thereza, I discussed inflation. I began the discussion with Nakano, the discussion of the inertial inflation theory. That is the more important thing that I had contributed to the economic theory before this. The same theory was developed also for economists in Rio de Janeiro, that you know, Basha. This was an important thing. And it's a long discussion. I don't have much things to tell you in this moment about this, except that I continue to say that two things, I add one thing. You should not fight inflation in two ways. One is controlling, controlling the exchange rate, using exchange rate as an anchor against inflation. And second, you should never do this with the prices of state-owned enterprise. This is a disaster. This was done by Ernesto Geisel in Brazil and was a disaster. This was done by Dilma now with Petrobras and the electrical. This is disastrous. But not so disastrous, but not so short-term disastrous as is the exchange rate. This is also disastrous. The profit problem. This is fundamental one. Look, if you are left-wing, from progressive, social democrat, I'm defining myself social democrat, center to the left. Always define. I voted for Dilma last elections against all my class, all my friends, all my. Not the intellectual friends, some intellectual friends voted with me, but the others. Anyway, but we have two alternatives. We socialists have two alternatives. We either believe that the revolution is near, and so we make the revolution. We use the theory of plus value, Marx's theory of plus value, show that capitalism is intrinsically unjust. It's based on a case of exploitation. And so we are against all capitalists. We fight all capitalists, and we make the revolution, and we establish socialism. This is what Marx believed. This was many socialists believed for many years, till the mid of the last century. But in the last but this the idea began to, since the 70s, Soviet Union stagnated, and in the 80s, China changed it to capitalism. In the 90s, Russia changed it to capitalism. So it seems that this alternative is not valid. What is the alternative? The alternative is a class coalition. A developmental and social class coalition.
What means this? The alternative is to think, and not always this is possible, that we can ally ourselves to the industrialists, that you can divide the capitalist class into groups. On one side, the industrialists, or sophisticated industries, more broadly, and the other side, the financier and the rentier capitalists. Rentier capitalists, the one that live out of dividends and interests and rents of real estate rents. If you can divide them in these two things, and you can ally with them, with this, and you can have growth and some distribution. This is what happened in the. This is what was the Fordist times of the. De la théorie de la régulation. This was happened in the Les Trente Glorieux, or the golden years of capitalism. There was a broad class coalition, and it was broadly a developmental class coalition. With neoliberalism, we had a very narrow class coalition, fully dominated by the rentier capitalists, the financiers, and in the rentier capitalists includes the middle class, the large middle class that's rentier. So you understand that I opt clearly for the second alternative. The first makes no sense. I think that this first alternative still makes sense for some people, some intellectuals that I really, really respect. When they are fundamentally critical. They are critics. Their role is to criticize. There is in Brazil, for instance, one that you heard about, Francisco de Oliveira, that's a fascinating guy when he criticizes. He criticizes very strongly. But he's not worried about in any way to manage the Brazilian economy. He's a sociologist, a little economist. He wants to come to criticize, and he criticizes very good, very well. Okay, this is a role. But when you are an economist that are supposed to be involved in policy and you are supposed to take care of your country, then you have to be, my view is that you have to be in a developmental class coalition. You have to be able to create this coalition, to participate in the creation of this, what's not easy, not simple. And if you do that, you have to have profits for them. Without profits, there is no capitalism. Without profit, there is no investment. Definitely. So you have to have profits for them. What you have to have is lower the least possible revenues for the rentier capitalists. We have to have taxes on them besides a low interest rate. And finally, my opinion, what's happening in Brazil recently. Look, in Brazil, there was not a devaluation policy. The devaluation happened, despite the fact that the central bank sold lots and lots of dollars. At least they made swaps, but it corresponds to swaps to sell. From their reserves were about 300 billion, went to 200 billion in net terms, due to the essay of the central bank to avoid the devaluation. In spite of that, the devaluation happened. Why? Because the fundamental cause of the devaluation was the fall of the price of commodities. This is theory. Nobody knows this. Some people know. The practical people in the financial sector that work with the exchange rate and make profits with the exchange rate, and they know, some of them. When the prices in August, September last year fall to less than half, for sure the exchange rate had to depreciate to maintain that firm's competitive. So this was one cause. This, plus the fact that the current account deficit was enormous, enormous. Last year, our foreign savings, that is current account deficit, were 4.6% of GDP. And I can assure you firmly, everything went to consumption. Nothing to investment, because the growth rate was zero. Last year, growth zero. This year, 3% less. The consequences of this social developmentalism are disastrous. Because this expression was used by a senator that made his PhD dissertation defended in Unicamp, and I was member of the committee. He's a very nice person. He held his dissertation in the end of the Lula administration. Things were rosy, and he made a big story and said that what was happening in Brazil was social developmentalism. Well, we saw by the comments that were presented that this was not so rosy as he thought. Thank you. No, no, it's questions. Olá.
To in the beginning of your presentation.
Mm-hmm.
Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me?
Yes, I'm listening. You don't need this. You don't need this.
Okay. But it's working?
Yeah,
it's working. Okay, so. I'd like to know what, because you first told about Prebisch, Furtado, these other economists of the Latin American structuralism. And you call yourself a new developmentalism. So
yes.
Some kind of relation you think you have with them.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, they propose that in the long run, that is what you're discussing, the tendencies of the capitalism, of Brazilian capitalism, etc. But they propose that they have, at least in the Prebisch and Furtado version, they have a tendency to balance of payment constraints in the long run. And this is resolved by some different kind of policies, but it seems to me that there's some sort of a difference between what we are talking, that you claims that there is a tendency to overvaluation of the exchange rate, while some of these economists claims that there's a tendency to a devaluation of the exchange rate or to inflation or to other kinds of consequences. So how do you see this difference with them? And the other thing that I would like to question, to know better about you, because you claim that Brazilian economy, deindustrialization was very much because of the Dutch disease, but the deindustrialization is a tendency of the whole economy since China took place and since the technology of information and computers and communication is in the economy. So how you deal with this tendency of the world capitalism, not only Brazil, while the Dutch disease is more related to the Brazilian economy?
Mm-hmm. Okay, the first thing, look, I always define myself as a developmentalist. I always define my masters in Brazilian economy, Inácio Rangel and Celso Furtado. Celso Furtado, you know. Inácio Rangel, a little older than him, was a very important and a very innovative economist, but he only wrote in Portuguese and nothing was published in other languages. I wrote a big paper before the death of each one of them, no? But before, no? Because they were my masters and I knew them. This, the paper on Celso Furtado is published in English also. Well, so I am very much, but as I told you, this theory was a theory in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And it was a limited theory that helped, it was important. was important to Latin America. Should be have important to Asia, but the Asians are very pragmatic. I don't know how much they learned. Anyway, which are the difference? They are big. The fundamental difference is that they believed in growth with foreign savings, and I don't. It's very clear on, on their part. The theory began with Rosenstein-Rodin, big push theory, and the big push is to be done through the introduction of foreign money, a big amount of foreign money to invest in the term and create externalities one to the others. There is a paper, a dissertation thesis in Brazil recently by one of my oriented, making a good description of the difference between the two theories. They are big. They don't have anything about macroeconomics. My theory is so the only thing that they have about macroeconomics is this so-called structural theory of inflation. This was something that two economists in the 50s defined the more important is not the Chilean, the other. I forgot his name now. But this was a good theory for a very poorly developed country. Once the markets began to develop, this kind of cause loses importance. So these people were also thinking in countries in a much different situation that we have now, international in terms, in development terms, etc. So the differences are big, and I said some of them here. The other question was about.
About the Dutch disease and the industrialization of Brazilian economy, but since
I remember well. Look, the question. There's two things in this question. Very good. That's the first. The one is that the industrialization is something that's happening everywhere. Especially that's happening in developed countries. Not in Germany, but in developed, not in a country that is already developed as Taiwan. But except for these two, the others are deindustrializing. But their deindustrialization, our pre-industrialization, is clearly premature. We began to industrialize much before we had an income per capita that as a head. So this was a very, very strongly premature kind of. And the consequence, in my view, are the very bad growth rates that we have. And which is the relation between this deindustrialization and this deindustrialization and the Dutch disease? Look, the Dutch disease in Brazil was neutralized between 1967 and 1990 through a system that they call the Delfineto system, because Delfineto was the finance minister that developed it, the organized the thing, and this left for some time after he left. And it was based very simply in a huge tariff, average tariff of 45%, and a huge subsidy to manufactured goods of also 45%. This represented a tax of 45% on the commodities, on the cost side. On the price side, 31%. The consequence was a huge industrialization. Anna presented, presented a figure about the increase of the participation of exports. The participation of exports in 1985 was 6% of total exports or manufacturing. In 1990 was the top, it was 62. The six to 62. Today is 37. This is the industrialization. What happened? What happened was in 1990, Brazil decided to open the economy. I was finance minister a few years before, 3 years before, and I began the opening. Why? Because I said, well, there's no reason for, Brazil is not has, does not have it anymore, infant industry. You don't need so much protection. And I didn't know that the half of this protection was not protection, was neutralization of the Dutch disease. Well, in 1990, I was left already, they opened radically the economy. The average Dutch tariff rate was from 45 to 12. And the result was an enormous closing of firms, a disastrous process. And since then, Brazil does not grow in industrial terms. For me, this was the new fact that since 1990, Brazil does not neutralize anymore its Dutch disease. There are other causes, but this, for me, is the more important. You know everything. Please look to my website. There's lots of things in English, a few things in French. There is a beautiful left side menu with all the themes. You can have fun. Thank you. Oh!
I didn't know you were finished.
Ah, yes. No, because I. Please.
So my name is Maria. I'm very glad that we have a Brazilian presenter at the seminar today.
Are you Brazilian also?
Yes, of course.
I have a granddaughter, Maria, the first granddaughter.
Yes. But I just have a small concern, actually. To keep the exchange rate devalued when you have to control inflation can be very tricky if you're thinking about like conventional monetary policies. Mm-hmm. So if you increase interest rates, normally you end up attracting foreign capital, and that can be a problem if you want to keep the exchange rate devalued. So, but in your article, you said that this effect will be temporary. And I would like you to shed some light in it. And also, you mentioned macroprudential policies to control inflation. But what if the cause of the inflation is external? Like when in 2011, we had the commodities that Brazil imported was they had a boom in prices. So we had inflation because of an external event. So maybe mm-hmm. in this case, we would actually need overvalued exchange rate because, the commodities that we import had a boom in prices. There is nothing we can do about it, so maybe. Mm-hmm. So what are your thoughts about it?
The first
about conciliating like devalued exchange rate and controlling inflation.
Mm-hmm. We had a specific thing in the beginning.
I talked about attracting foreign capital when you increase interest rates.
You see how her question is very good because it's a question of an economist. What means, what's a question of economics? Because a question of economics, prices are in, and you win in one line, you lose in the other. The blanket is short. Then, to control inflation, if you cannot use the exchange rate, you are supposed to use the interest rate and the fiscal policy. If you use the interest rate, you attract capitals. This attracting capitals appreciates, but this appreciates, and this is good for controlling inflation. But The fact is that the economist has to manage all the time the things. When I see a capitalist economy, I see the capitalist economy divided, as I told you very fast, happily, in two sectors, the competitive and the non-competitive. But this is the microeconomics, the micro aspect. Now, and we need a strong control, planning of the non-competitive, and leave it the market to the other, the less regulation as possible. Now, instead of looking to the microeconomics, I look at the macroeconomics. In this case, macroeconomics, the market definitely does not work as should. Works. All this theory is based on the market, but you have to manage all the time. Then this question that you are posing is typically one very, very well posed. The controls of credit, all these things can be used. But what I am very strongly saying is that we should not wrong the price of the exchange rate or wrong the price of the state-owned enterprises. State-owned enterprises that are very important for the country, because the state-owned enterprises are also a source of investment. State-owned enterprises make large profits, and large profits can be reinvested. All this was captured by private enterprises in all these times. And this happens because we live under imperialism. The West is imperial. They are receiving you very nicely here, giving you births, etc. But they hope that you come back believing all the things that they believe and not the things that you should believe, because they are interested in their countries, what's reasonable. They want that you grow with foreign savings. They want that we get indebted with them by all means. They want to legitimize their multinationals with our current account deficits. So I hope you be able to fight this imperialism on your part. Bye-bye. Thank you.